In this lab, we are going to complete task 1 to task 3, experimenting with batch functions, setting up CGI programs, passing data to a batch via environment variables. So now let's open the official website to open the lab menu and the lab setup files. In this lab, it will set up a Docker container. So for Docker, you may open this Docker manual for further information. Here is a seed manual for containers. So I'll go through these links to learn Docker. Here's the manual. We will follow the manual to complete task 1 to task 3. Task 1, the environment setup. We need to set up this environment. Then we will go through task 1 to task 3. Okay, first, set up the environment. Before that, let's download the lab setup file first. Save link as lab04. Save it. Lab04. Extract here. Okay, here are the files that we need. Now we can follow the manual to complete the environment setup. First, set up DNS. We need to check this etc host file on our virtual machine. We have this line. So open a terminal window. You may use any command you want. For example, use less etc hosts. You can use your JK key, J to move down, K to move up. So I use my J to move down. Here you see for the shell shock lab, we have this line. So DNS setting is good. Now the container setup. To quit this one, type Q, quit. Now close it. Container setup, we need to go inside the folder we just unzipped, that lab setup. Go inside and run this command. It will download a seed image. That image contains the materials we need for the lab. These are the commands built in this into this seed virtual machine. So in this lab setup, we unzipped a moment ago. Right click, open a terminal window here. Now inside the terminal window, we run this Docker Compose build, then bring it up, and if you want to shut down, run this command. So, Docker Compose. Actually, I built one during the lecture, so let me build it again to see what will happen. Okay, it actually it detected one in is already built. That's why it's so fast. That from the cache hell from the repository. When you run this command, it will take a little bit of time to download the image, as I demonstrated during the lecture. So now I have this one, right? And here is a container ID. This is a container ID. That is the immediate container ID. This is the final container ID. How do I find all the containers? Docker container list. Okay, because no container is running, so nothing show up. Now let's run it. Docker compose up. It started the container. Now I have a problem because I run one is already in use by this container. That is the image, the container name, the container name. So if you didn't run it during the lecture, you will not have this problem. Now I need to solve this problem. You have to remove or rename that container to be able to reuse that name. Docker list, Docker image list. I have one here, image ID when I built it like 2 minutes ago, but this one I built Monday, this Monday. So these are the images. Image ID now. Actually, we can run this images directory. Run, for example, we want to run this one. So for the Docker commands, you can always type help to see a list of this command, how to use it. I can see all these commands. For that Docker container, can also see a little help. Can remove one or more containers. As I just run that one Docker compose up, it says I used one. Now we can use a Docker container ORM to remove it. So that that one here, we can remove this one. You may specify the name or this ID. So why this ID is so long, I don't know. You need to check the Docker user manual. Docker container remove. Let's use this string to see whether it worked or not. It didn't say it's removed or not. So this output just output this string. Looks like a shortcode. So how about the name? Here's the name. Can copy it. Docker container remove. No such container, it's already removed. So you use this string, maybe a shortcode or something. Both can be used to identify this container. You may use its name or use its the shortcode stuff. Compose Now we can print up. Okay, the web server is printed up. If we want to close it, open a new tab. There are two ways. You use another tab run this command, or inside this one you type Ctrl C to stop it. Okay, now if I type docker compose done, just stopping this one. So after your lab, please stop your container. Okay, now you see the container, they are both stopped and removed. Because during the lecture I didn't run this docker compose down, so it's still inside, it's not removed. And you also see here it exited. Bring up again, because it's removed, so it's safe to use it again. Okay, start it up. You may use this abbreviated alias for this command. For other stuff, for example, how to list the running container, you may run a docps. Docps is an alias for this long command. And you see it shows my container is running with the name and this ID. So this ID is different from that shortcode streamline. You can use this ID to show it. This one is run a shell on this docker machine. So let's run it. Docker shell sh is the alias for this one. You may type this one docx-it followed by the ID, and you run this bin shell. This bin shell is the shell inside the container. This ID is a container ID. So just use the simplest one. And copy and paste here. Right. Okay, now we are inside this container. We may run several containers at the same time, and just like this. In our later labs, I think we may need several containers at the same time. Okay, now keep this container running and keep this interface into this container up. The web server and CGI. We can check this inside the container, right? We checked this one during the lecture. And we have two files inside. You can use a cat to see its content. I prefer less. Less user lab CGI bin var. Less command not found. It's not installed. Because the container is quite small. Only needed programs are installed. Okay, this is a content. And also we can check the content of the other one. Since we practiced in our lecture, and when you may cut it by yourself. Now we can open this link in your browser. Here you see a hello over there. Or you open with this curl command by yourself. Now we are ready to do these three tasks. The first task we want to try this vulnerable version, bash shell shock. You can run it in the container or on your computer. Design an experiment to verify whether this bash is vulnerable to a shell shock attack or not. Conduct the same experiment on the patched version of the bin shell and report your observation. So you may do it in the container or do it in our virtual machine. Just open a new tab. LS image www. We have this vulnerable version is here. Right? You may copy that one. Lab setup. Copy it to your lab 04. Copy it here. Bash shell shock. How do we verify it? So we need the slides. So you can follow the slides to design an experiment. Find the slide. Shell shocker. Here we want to scroll up to find that one about the shell shock attack on SetUID program. You can go through from here. Set up the vulnerable program. Let's see whether the program is provided or not. Here it's not provided. It's not provided in this lab setup. So we need to create one by ourselves. For this one, actually, you can find on our course companion website the code provided to you. That is var.c. So you may use this one. Control A, Control C. Come to our folder lab 04. You may open the editor, gEditor from here. Tag the editor. Control V, paste here. Then save it. Click this save button. Save it to my lab 04. Oops, it's not there. So where I put it? Quite var.c. Okay, we have this file. Now we can follow this slides. It uses system to run it. So follow this part. First set up that bin shell, we can check it, bin sh, it's linked to z shell, so we need a sudo so you may need to copy this bash shell shock to your bin folder. Here, this is a bash shell shock. So for those students didn't copy it during the lecture, so you may need to copy it now. Sudo copy this bash shell shock to your bin folder. Okay, now it's inside your bin folder, you can double check it. It's over there. So now you can run this sudo command. sf bin bash shell shock. Double check. Okay, it's linked to this vulnerable shell. Now we can compare this program. Just follow the slides. gcc var.c dash o var. Now we can run it normally. Var. It just lists the content in my current folder. Because you will see, check the source code, it will run this bin ls dash l. Now, change it to a celluloid program owned by root. So do change owner root var, change its mode 4755 var, double check. It's a celluloid program, it's 8 bit and owned by root. It's good. Now we attack it using this shell shock vulnerability. So we export any function that is useful. Echo say normal function. Then we follow the bin shell. So export this one and run that one war program again. Okay, you see this, we got a root shell, so which means we attacked the system through this shell shock vulnerability and got the root privilege. Now we can't do anything. The computer is under our control. This is the lab. We design an experiment to verify this bash is vulnerable to shell shock attack. This bash shell shock. And yes. Now we conduct the same experiment on the good version, the patched version. We just need to change that link. First exit this root shell we got. Okay, we only need to change the soft link to the patched bash. The patched bash was a good bash. Double check. Now it's linked to this patched version. Okay, we can launch the attack again. We know that the environment variable is still there. If you are unsure, you can double check. It's still there. So now we run this var again. And you see the attack failed with this patched version. That vulnerability is removed or is corrected in this patched version. So we cannot use the shell shock attack anymore. So this is task one. Now task two, passing data to bash where environment variables using the container. Right? On the container, we have getInfo.cgi. The middle one, we know we have getInfo.cgi. you can use a cat to show its content. Get m dot cji, right? Everything is there, and here this string will show the environment variable. Oh, the bash run, and you see it's a vulnerable bash on the container, and the container we consider is the web server. So you can see it here. Just change this one to get in .cji. You see all the environment available from the container or the server. Now we want to pass environment variable to the server or to the container. 2.a, use the browser, we already see it, right? You use the browser, we see there is a HTTP user agent, this one, you need to highlight in your report. Here, this line, the agent, the Mozilla, we use it. And this environment variable is passed from our client, this Firefox, on our virtual machine to the container. And the container send it back here, showing this web page. Now use a curl command. You can run these four commands inside the terminal window. Make sure you run them in your virtual machine bash, not this container shell. So run here. To see the virtual machine VM. First command, paste here. Which parameter we set? This dash V. Which one we set, dash V. So you need to check the curl command as usage. Curl dash dash help. What does that dash V mean? Dash V mean verbose, just make the operation more talkative, more readable. Just dash V. It will show the header of the HTTP request. So you need to highlight the header you got. Here, you need to highlight the header you got. Oops. This is the header part. This is the response. This is the request. Now, for this dash A, which environment variable will be set, or which parameter will be set. Dash E, dash H, set some fields in the header request. And you need to figure out what fields are set by each of them. So including your findings in the lab report. So it's easy to find out in the output, in your response, right? Here you can find from here, check that value, whether that value is yours, my data, and this is AAABBB. Here we run this one. Oops. So you run by yourself. And from that output, find my data here, so you know this one is a set. For the other one, the other two, you just do it by yourself. And based on this experiment, please describe what options or curl can be used to inject data into the environment variables of the target CGI program. So at least now we know this one worked. For the other two worked or not, you check it by yourself. Now task 3, launching the shell shock attack. So maybe let's just check this one. Paste here. Now I want to see whether my data is still here. Right? My data is here. This time it set up this HTTP referral. Referral is set by this dash E. How about this dash uppercase H? Paste here, run it. Now again, go up to see whether you can see that AABB. AABB is here. It still can be used. So all three options can be used. However, this one is a little bit weird, right? HTTP, you create a customized variable name, or you use a create a variable name. This part is as a is just appended to this HTTP underscore. Then this is the value here. You use a colon and followed by empty space. So now we want to launch the shell shock attack. We know, we already know in the container here, in the container it used the vulnerable shell, right? The vulnerable shell. So your job is to launch the attack through this URL, var.cgi, so you can get the server to run arbitrary command. So how do we do that? So we need to pay attention to this explanation. If your command has a plain text output and you want output returned to you, your output needs to follow a protocol, should start with this one, print text, followed by an empty line, and then you place your print text output. If you want your server to return a list of files in the folder, your command would look like the following, look like this. Now in this attack, please use three different approaches, three different HTTP head fields to launch the shell shock attack against the target CGI program. You need to achieve the following objectives. You need to use one approach, but in total you need to use three different ones. Send back the content of password file. Get server tell you it's a process user ID, use bin ID. The last one, get the server to create a file inside the temp folder, and you need to get into the container to see whether the file is created or not, or use another shell shock attack to list its content. The last one, get the server to delete the file you just created. So you need to complete these four tasks. So the first one, we can try this one to have a look, right? This one. How do we construct it? Again, check the slides. We scroll down. Find out how to do that. Here you write, you construct or pass an environment variable to the container. Like So we can use this curl dash a. Curl dash a, then construct this share function. Echo hello. Right. Then followed by that echo. This is the extra command, the malicious part. Content type is text. Line, echo empty line, then run the command, the malicious command, bin ls dash r. And we know we need this one, right? We need that this link. We can copy this link, paste it here. Oops. Copy link location. Okay, this command we are going to construct, we pass this function definition, the share function definition, with the malicious code through this dash a parameter, and access this link. We know this link it's vulnerable, as we see inside the root. Oops, my bad. I type in the root share. I made the mistake again. Just cut it. No cut, I copy it. Delete it. We know that var.cji, right? That var.cji is here. This var.cji is just show a hello world. Okay, please pay attention. You must launch the attack in your seed VM, not inside that container. The container is the server. So I paste it here. Now I run it. You see the files from the server are listed out, right? The getinfo.cji, var.cji. You can compare here. Here, user lab cgi, you have these two files. Because we use ls dash l, it will list out like this. When you check here, right, they are the same. So we just construct example. Now, with this example, we are asked to get the server to send back the content of this etc password file. Okay, how do we do that? We just modify the vulnerable code. So the vulnerable code, we can use a bin cat, right? Then etc password. We are asked to get the etc password file, get its content. So we run it. You see this password content. Again, you can compare it with through the container shell. We use cat etc password. Get the same result. So this task 3A is done. Now, get the server to tell you its process ID. just bring up this one. In your lab, you need to change a to dash e and dash h. Okay, now let's change it to dash e. Dash e. And we want to run that ID program, right? Just a bin ID. And press enter. You will get the ID information. Oh, which process? Oh, that bash which executed this var.cci on the container, on the server. Let's just call it a server. If you launch a remote attack on a real world server, so this container, you just consider it as a real world server. So you see the ID, right? These are the IDs, 3333. But now you see it's a www-data. This is a very limited a user with a very limited privilege, so you cannot do many stuff. Now, create a file inside the temp folder. The temp folder is a word writable folder. That's why even you are with this limited privilege, you'll still be able to write a file into that word writable folder, temp. So how do we do that? Now we use another option, that dash h. Can use that dash h. In that dash h, how do we construct it? The dash h has two parts. First part is the variable name. So you can say attack, choose any name you want. Then, m space, followed by the value of that http underscore attack is constructed automatically as we did before a moment ago, right? Then we change this malicious code. Okay, the malicious code, we want to create a file inside that temp folder. How do we do that? How to create a file? We can use a touch command, right? Touch command. Bin touch. Now give it a name. Let's call it virus. You inject a virus, create a virus in that temp folder. So you need to specify its location. TMP virus, like this. Now let's see whether the attack can be launched or not. Press enter. We get nothing because this one returns nothing. So actually you can let it return something. As it says, you may check inside the container. So we can check inside the container. Temp. Right? You see virus is written into this temp folder on the server. Another way we can print show its status. So how do we show its status? We just add one more command, right? One more command. Bin ls dash l temp folder. So you press enter. Okay, what's the mistake I made? I run this one, then I run this one to list that temp folder. But you see, I didn't get that virus show up here. So why this one does not work? we created one soul. We know this one will not show up. So let's modify a little bit. How about I use and, which means when it succeed, it will open up. It will run this one. So actually, I think this one should be equivalent to this one, right? So we may run another attack just to show it up. Okay, we see it. With two commands, it does not work. A single command, it will work. So we get this result back. In the real world, we need it this way, right? Because we don't have access to the server like this. Now, get the server to delete that file you just created. So we just bring up, we already practiced the three ways, dash A, dash H, dash E. So it's okay, we use dash H again. Just modify this attack malicious code. So you may bin remove TMP virus, and remove that virus. But under first way, you may check it here inside the container. Now you see it's gone, then one see it's gone. Again, another way you check it here, as we just did. Use the this shell shock attack, and you see it say total zero. Zero files inside that folder, which means that virus is removed. So now we need to figure out why two commands does not work. It should work for many numbers of extra commands, right? For example, we echo this one, then echo this one, then run this command. Do we need another echo? Okay, maybe we need another echo here. This echo is going to type plain echo, then run this command, right? So we can just add two more. Copy it. For example, we want to create that. Let's bring up that one here, this one. Now we paste this echo, another echo, container type, and echo. And use that alias to list out the file we created in the temp folder. So now let's see whether this works or not. We just copy this part, put it in front of every command. Press enter. It still does not work. Okay, you may ask Google to see why it does not work. How about use other I don't think it will work. Okay, you may Google to see why this one does not work. It's not required. Now the questions. Will you be able to steal the contents of that shadow file from the server? Why not? So we know the user privilege we got through this attack is just www-data. So it's a limited one. It's unlikely, so we will not be able to get that etc shadow file. We know etc shadow file is a privilege file. So we can use that bincat command. Bincat, you change this one, the password to shadow. And run it, we got nothing, right? Shadow will not work because as it says, you check task 3B. Our privilege is www-data. This is the reason why we cannot get it. Question 2 for this one. Typically attach data in the URL after the question mark like this. This could be another approach that we can use to launch the attack. In the following example, we attach some data in the URL and we found that the data are used to set the following environment variable. Here, user. I think this is UEOY string. So what's that one? And can this method to launch the shell shock attack conduct your environment and derail your conclusion? So let's try it. Let's copy it and paste here. We know that getIn.cgi is used to show the environment variables. Right? You see, we can get the environment variables. Request URI looks like this from this port. Query string. Here, the query string. So there is a typo here. Query string AAAA. Now, how could we launch the attack? Shell shock attack. Again, we need to replace this AAA part, right? To shell function definition followed with malicious code. But there is one thing. This is a HTML. String, so which means we need to encode it as HTML. So if we run that, if we use that attack, shell shock attack. First, you may just try it, you will see it will not work. So how do we construct that one? We know construct like this, there's a function echo normal. So I think I need to bring up those stuff, I don't remember. Yeah, we just copy this one, this whole stuff. Now, if we just paste here directly, paste like this, you see it says a bad request. It will not work. So how could we make it work? Do we need a string to enclose this one? Enclose it like this. It still says bad request. Actually, that AA, do you need a single quote? You can check single quote what we get. The single quote is added. Okay, the reason is we need HTML encode. Let's say HTML encode. Encode online. That single code, we don't need it, right? So let's copy this part. And paste here. Encode. So this encode is exactly the same. HTML, your error encoding. You want to encode? Put it here. Result will appear here. Encode the URL. So we've got something like this. So we copy it. Go back. Now we need to change this part. Paste here. And run it. We run it, what do we get? Because we use this get CGI, right? You still see the other stuff. The question is like this. As we want to use that var.cgi. We only see a hello world, we didn't see the attack. And we know this attack is used to show the content on the server, but I didn't get it. Here we encoded this part, which is your error stream. So if I don't encode it, go back to Nidada, get into a war. Here, single quote here. And run it. It's a bad request. Okay, I need to find out how to encode this string. So it looks like this port does not work. Okay, for this one, I will find out later and post on our Quartz Companion website.